Thank you very much for having me here. I have to say, before my formal remarks, I'm having a great time. My wife Janet is back here. We just got back from Kangaroo Island and just are having a marvelous time. So let me begin about who I am. Well, you heard that my formal degree and some of the things I have done, I'm of course very proud of that, but probably the two best things that has ever happened to me, I married Janet, and we have one son, Joe, who is our very best joint venture ever. Just no questions about that. To know sort of who I am, I like to lift weights, and I like to read literary classics. So these are these things that you don't hear about speakers too much. Now, the part that's psychologically revealing, perhaps, is that things I would like to do, I call these fantasies because I may never get to do these, but I would like to do 40 bar dips. I don't know if you remember what bar dips are from when you were in school, but my goal in life, one of my goals in life, is to do 40 of those things. I think this is quite doable, but the fantasy which I will probably never do, I will never run a mile in 9 minutes. Age has caught up with me. Unfortunately, age has caught up to me when I was about 25. So this is perhaps what we call in the United States a pipe dream, but I still fantasize about it. Well, I want to start out by presenting a few statistics so you have a sense of where I'm coming from. And I want to talk about, just very, very briefly, meta-analyses. I don't want to bore you with any of the details, but you hear about meta-analyses primarily when you hear about medical reports. So the latest disease, the latest thing is good or bad for you based on meta-analyses. It's simply a statistical summary of a large number of studies. The key statistics is a weighted average correlation, and it ranges from -1 to +1, with 0 having no meaning. This is important because you get a sense. It is not the totality of what we know, but it is a sense of what we know. So, what do we know about turnover? The most common predictors include the intention to leave, and that's sort of a polite way of saying, I will be leaving. It's the notion that if you intend to do something, a very high probability follows that you're going to do it. Intention to search. I always note the difference between intention to search and actual searching for another job. That's in part driven because we all know of some people who are seriously looking for a job, and those people are sort of casual. I'm always hesitant to say this because this was so long ago that perhaps everything I know about my work career is so dated, it's probably dangerous. But I had a colleague on the first day of work in this company. First day of work, he had a PhD in industrial psychology. He started looking at the want ads. And so I started, gee, you just got here and you're looking for a new job? He made the comment that he's always looking for a new job, and he's been in his last job for about 25 years plus, maybe 30 years, and he's still looking for a job. So there are just those people, and it makes things a bit more complicated. Thinking of quitting and perceived alternative. As you can see, none of these things are gigantically robust. And what then becomes the issue is, how do we put things together? It's like a jigsaw puzzle. How do you put things together? Just a few more predictors. We often talk about attitudes. Organizational commitment is one of those powerful attitudes that we have used successfully for quite a while. Job satisfaction, certainly everybody knows about it. It is the most intuitive thing. But note, it only predicts, sort of. Job satisfaction, which is the one we talk about all the time, I always say the power of job satisfaction is that I call it the cardinal job attitude, because its beauty, its grace, its elegance is that so much of what we do psychologically shoots through job satisfaction. In statistical terms, we call it a mediator, and that's a fancy way of saying it controls a whole lot of other job attitudes. I will come back to these things. And absenteeism and job performance are correlated to a statistically significant level, but those aren't considered gigantic correlations. So with that, this is one of those sort of intellectual abstractions where in some areas, sometimes some ideas are too intuitive. They are too powerful and too consistent, and they stall thinking and action. I call them showstoppers. When you think about, well, what the heck is a showstopper? I'm going to be pie in the sky and talk about great lofty things before I bring it back to reality and talk about what I do. But think about this. I'm not a scholar of astronomy, so I may get some of this wrong, but I don't know if you remember from your high school or college classes, Ptolemy. And Ptolemy was one of the first great astronomers. And he said, well, gosh, this is not hard. Look around. Everything is around us. Therefore, the Earth is the center of the universe. Kind of hard to disagree. All your physical impressions, everything was, yeah, you know, look over there. Look over there. Everybody's around. What the heck? You know, we must be the center of the Earth. And then, I honestly do not know how many years later, but quite a few centuries later, as I understand it, Copernicus. He said, you know, that's just not right. And like a great astronomer, he brought all kinds of, for the day, mathematical kinds of observational-based data and says, you know, that just the numbers don't seem to work out. And that really, the sun is the center of our solar system. Well, the Catholic Church was not happy with the guy, and they harassed him for most of his life. And he had the courage to say, no, let's go with what the numbers say. Don't hold me to this one, so this is just between you and me. I'm told, and I do not know this, Galileo was his student. Galileo also believed in the numbers and said, you know, you do all these calculations, even if you look around, it's not reality. The sun is the center of the solar system. And there's a legend. I don't know if this is true, but I was told this by an astronomy professor, that both Galileo and Copernicus were threatened that they would be executed if they didn't recant what they say. And Galileo, being a smart man, said, okay, I better recant. So he, in front of a big audience, he had to get down on his knees and recant and say he was wrong. The Earth is the center of the universe. And the urban legend, so to speak, is that as he stood up, he said, but it's not. It didn't kill the guy, so it must have worked somehow. So as we come back to management research, which is on certainly a much smaller scale than the stars, astronomy, and planets, absolutely one of those showstoppers. It is both a valid statement and intuitive, but it is limiting. They first started talking about this in 1958. Now, I was born in 1952, so this is a long time ago. And they talked about it. I mean, scholars are not quick. They are slow, methodical. And so they started talking about it in 1958, and it wasn't until 1977 that somebody says, gee, we should put this idea to test. And from 1977 to approximately 1978, and I'm 1977 to 1987, I'm sorry, 1987, and I'm happy to tell you that one of my first publications was what they call at the University of South Australia an A-star journal, where I was among the last to test this. We know that if you don't like your job and have someplace else to go, the probability of leaving goes up. That took 60 years to think about. It took 10 years. And I think about all the people who, in my system, got tenured, promoted, earned multi-million dollar grants by saying, gosh, you know, this is what happens. Well, this is all good, but I think my misguided story is very similar to what a lot of people go through. I started my dissertation on turnover in 1982, and I was so naive, I thought, my gosh, if it was published, it must be true with a capital T. I mean, I really did think that. And so I started a couple, three studies testing this basic idea, because there was about five major different models that all said the same thing. So these five different scholars got major papers, major publications by saying basically the same thing. I tested one of those theories. And like everybody else, it sort of worked and sort of didn't. So my sense was after, literally, I published three papers, and they all said the same thing. Yeah, kind of works, kind of not. So being very naive, I said, it must not be the theory. It must be how we're doing it. And so, good or bad, I went into what I call my flight into statistics phase. And I studied statistics pretty intensely and actually published two major papers, A star papers, on bringing a method called survival analysis or event history analysis to the management literature. I had this, this is also just between you and me. At that time, right around that time, I read a study or a set of comments by famous people. The most well-cited person was a guy named Kronbach. And Kronbach said, you know, you ought to write a methods paper because then everybody will cite you. So I thought, yeah, this is the way to go, and this is what I'm going to do. So I write the statistics paper. Unfortunately, I would tell you, we've had some success, but I'm not a legendary figure I thought I was going to be based on these statistical papers. Well, we had better tools. We came up with these better tools. And we tested it. We got better, stronger results. So I'm absolutely convinced this is a good thing to do, that if you have better tools, you will get better results. But you're never going to make the great breakthrough by simply having better tools. One of the stories that I tell now that is funny, but when I was first told, when I heard this, it wasn't so good. One of my senior colleagues at the time was Terry Mitchell, a man, good, very, very good friend, man I work with now. And we first started interacting. He said, Tom, turnover research is a failed area. There's nothing here. And I thought, geez, I'm putting my future on this. And you're telling me this is a failed area? That was not a good way to start. Well, in the American system, one of the great things is when you get tenured. That means that after 6 years of struggle, going through what they call the assistant professor years, and the best way to perhaps describe the assistant professor years is the notion of when you're going through it, the feeling you have, I mean, absolutely, 99% of the people, 99.9% of the people, have this feeling, no matter what you do, no matter how much you do, it's not enough. And you go through this for 6 years, you finally get tenured, and you say, yes. And then, to burst the bubble, one of my faculty members says, well, Tom, you know, this is like not getting hit in the head. I said, what does that mean? He said, well, if you get denied tenure, it's like getting hit in the head, and if you don't, or if you get tenure, it's like not getting hit in the head. I thought, geez, that's not very glamorous. But nonetheless, I thought, okay, this is my time. This is when I make my mark. I'm going to become somebody who people remember, or I'm going to be a footnote in this whole process. And so I said, well, gosh, why do people leave? And on the day that I got tenured, I actually drove over to this colleague, Terry Mitchell's house, and we started talking about both. Well, how do you get promoted to full professor? What do you have to do? I actually wanted him to tell me, what's the secret sauce? So yeah, I could just go do it and have it happen. And then I gave him my preliminary ideas on voluntary turnover, and it was to become the unfolding model. And I'm going to explain what that is momentarily. But from the start of 1990 to now, so approximately 23 years, with some exceptions, of course, we have met virtually every week for 23 years with students, other colleagues who float in and out, talking about various topics, with turnover and retention being our main area. Tonight, I want to talk about what we have found and what we think is kind of important. Boy, I talk a lot, I'll tell you. Just time's going by. Well, the unfolding model is a general set of ideas where we talk about how do you group variables, group ideas in a cogent fashion, and how do you bring in the role of time. Something that in turnover research, obviously, you're predicting something in the future, whether somebody leaves. But how that unfolds over time has not, at that time, was just not well studied. We thought our contribution would be how you bring in time. The main concepts that where we differed in the prior statement, if you don't like your job, so job dissatisfaction, if you don't like your job, that's the start of the leaving process. We said, well, sometimes. And we said, we had this idea called shocks or jarring effects, jarring events that precipitates thoughts of quitting. This was another way, and until we did some research, we didn't know how often it was a precipitating event. But we heard stories about people who were leaving jobs when they were satisfied, completely contrary to what the conventional wisdom is. Truth be told, this is not a good word. But by the time we published it, we couldn't take it back. If I had to do it over again, I would have never picked that word. That was my fault for picking that word, because shocks has this negative connotation, and we did not mean negative any kind of negative connotation. I was still at my semi-flight into statistics, and there was a statistical method where one of the terms is shocks to the system, and I thought that was a cool-sounding word, and so we picked it. Whoops. Process. One of the processes is from image theory. How do you make decisions? How do you judge things? And my colleague Terry Mitchell and another colleague of his had just proposed a new theory of decision making, and it was very different than what our traditional rational models are, or our intendedly rational models are. They said, well, gosh, how do you make the big decisions? The big decisions are based on consistency or violation of three images. The three images are your fundamental values, you as a core person. Does this thing that you want to do fit with your core values? You have a set of goals that are more immediate. They could be career goals. And you have a thing called plans with which to get your or attain your career goals. And this is how you sort of check in a yes-no fashion. This fits me. I am an accountant. Therefore, I'm going to be doing accounting stuff. I am, deep in my heart, a person who wants to work with the soil. Therefore, deep in my heart, I want to work something in agriculture. You develop goals. You think about goal plans and how you attain them. And when you make your big decisions, you decide whether the decision fits those three images. So we utilized that idea, and we came up also with a concept of scripts. Again, I take full responsibility. That's a horrible word to use, because in social psychology, there's all these very highfalutin notions of exactly what a script is, and in reality, I simply meant you have a plan. So that's sort of my fault, or it's caused me enormous heartache, I can't tell you, whenever I talk to a group of social psychologists. And what do you think? Decide before the leaving decision. And you think about job search, and you think about how many offers you get and how this plays in. According to our rational theory, that from conventional wisdom up until about 1990, it was, well, gosh, you're going to take a job that gives you something better than what you currently have. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. I am told by my good friend, Peter Hom, that I use too many polysyllabic words. I sound too highfalutin. And he says, no, that's not what you mean. This is what you mean. I liked it so much, I just use it now. He said, in our theory, you have four basic prototypes, or paths, as we call them. And the first path is basically follow a plan. I'll give you examples momentarily. But a personal event, a jarring event, shocks you. And the shock could be not necessarily bad. It activates your plan, and then you subsequently quit. This could be things like, many people, when they graduate from school, from their undergraduate degree, say they're going to work a few years, and then they're going to go back and get an advanced degree. Happens a lot. Another very common example that we have found, many women say, well, I graduate from with my bachelor's degree. I'm going to work a few years. I'll get married. I'll get pregnant, and I'll quit for a while. Then I'll go back. I mean, these are well-established plans that you can actually count. The second one, Peter called, I'm out of here. I'll give you some more examples, but a negative event happens. It violates your fundamental values. It's so abhorrent that you quit. Just one quick example. If somebody says, you know, we want you to take this nuclear material and dump it in the river. I mean, this is horrible. And somebody may ask you to do that, and you say, No. I'll give you some more examples momentarily. The third path is leaving for something better. I'll give you an example again momentarily. It's just as one example, unsolicited inquiry. You compare it to your current job, and you quit for that better job. Again, very simple ideas. I'm going to elaborate on these with some more detail. And then the more traditional idea is leaving a dissatisfying job. Here the idea is over time. You do not have a shock, but over time, gradually, you may change, the job may change, and you don't fit anymore. And so that's where job dissatisfaction gradually accumulates in a very rational, logical fashion. You start searching, and then you do the comparisons of, am I better off in the old job or the new job? And then you make your choice about quitting. Just some details. Prototype one. Yes, there is a shock. It can be positive, neutral, or negative. That's where shock is kind of a bad term, because you can't have a positive shock. getting pregnant, having a baby can be a very wonderful, wonderful thing. On the other hand, under some conditions, it may not be so good. Job dissatisfaction. Oh, I'm sorry, there's a matching script. This is what you're going to do because this is your plan. We interviewed a number of snowboarding people. I like snowboarders, so we would talk to snowboarders. And a lot of snowboarders said, hey, this is what I'm doing. I'm going to work until the snow melts. That's kind of a shock. You quit. You get another job to cover the off season. You wait on tables. You do whatever you do. And when the snow comes back, you quit. And you're going to snowboard again. You're up there for the season. That's what you do. A lot of young people have this kind of sense of this is what they're going to do. Gap years are often this script that you might have. Job dissatisfaction, irrelevant. It may be there, but you're going to quit. Actors, another wonderful example. You're waiting tables, you're driving a cab, and when you get the opportunity to try out for a play, a Broadway play, no question, that's what you're going to do because that fits you better. There's no job search because this is all laid out. This is what you're going to do. Examples of the trailing spouse. We all know of those people whose spouses get a job. The other spouse, typically the female, follows them to someplace else. The trailing spouse may love their job, but they're going to go. The return to school. This is the one that has always bothered me. We had this research consulting opportunity in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. For those of you who do not know Sioux Falls, South Dakota, in their wintertime, they wish and long for 0 degrees. 0 degrees in Sioux Falls, South Dakota is considered a hot wave, and that people will walk out without a jacket because it's zero, and this is so cool. I mean, you got some very hardy, serious types there. Well, in Sioux Falls, they had a particular very successful company, the one we were consulting with and doing a research project for, that had the standard policy. They were known as training people extremely well. Then upon completion of training at Christmas time, they gave you a $500 bonus, and you were supposed to go on to your job. They had this problem about 80% of the people quit at that moment. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that they worked, they got educated and trained very, very well, got their $500, and were gone. They're going to go work someplace else. So we came up with a practical recommendation. Well, gosh, you know, maybe you ought to consider giving the $500 bonus 1 year after you complete the training. And it's one of those things where they just never thought of that kind of stuff. It's just kind of remarkable. Path two, there is a shock. It is almost negative. There's no matching script. You do this fit analysis with your value. Job dissatisfaction occurs only after the shock. It's not there until this process unfolds. There's no job search. I gave the example of participation in an illegal act. Something that we only read about, something which we did not discover, but I think everybody knows in the United States, September 11, 2001 was this momentous time. In the interviews of the survivors of the Twin Towers, a large number of people, when interviewed, said, you know, this was such a horrific, horrible event. I'm going to quit. I may have a great job making hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. I have everything I want, but this was so bad. It violates all these images and all these values I had. I just can't go back, and I will do something else. Such a horrible event led them to quit these wonderful jobs. Our theories do not explain that kind of behavior. Clearly, that kind of event does not happen very often, but there are natural disasters. Survivors of forest fires, survivors of awful events, survivors of layoffs oftentimes have very similar survivor kinds of guilt. Path three, this is a simple idea of, yes, there's a shock to the system, and it can be, again, positive, neutral, or negative. No matching script, but there is a fit analysis. Job dissatisfaction is relative only. So you made your job search, but it's only in the sense of figuring out what your alternative was. The prime example is a unexpected job offer. The two examples I love, they're a little bit dated, but I come from Microsoft country, and so when Microsoft was the all-powerful company, we had to bow 7 times a day to Microsoft. So we always have Microsoft stories. Rob Glazier was one of the senior vice presidents, making in approximately 1992, you know, he was clearly a multimillionaire because of Microsoft stock. Microsoft was famous at that time for not paying a great deal, but for a senior executive, not a CEO, he was making very, very good money. And when he quit his job, the press always asked, well, why'd you quit? He came up with this wonderful story that fits this so well. He said that, I'm 75% job satisfied. I don't know what that means, 75% job satisfied, but sure sounds good for my theory. 75% job satisfied, but you know what I really want to do? I want to have my own company. And I'm assuming the press accounts are relatively accurate, and so he started Real Networks. And for a relatively few years, it was a real powerhouse. It's still around, and it's still an active company, and Rob Glazier is very successful and very wealthy, but he always wanted to be his own boss. The other example I absolutely love, there's a woman named Stonecipher, and Stonecipher told the press, as a senior vice president at Microsoft, she had Patsy Stonecipher. She had the greatest job in the world. A year later, she quit. When people asked her, well, gosh, you had the greatest job in the world, so why did you quit? She said, I got the opportunity to work for the Gates Foundation, and the Gates Foundation fundamentally could change the world. They have more money than any other foundation. They have a whole army of extraordinarily talented and qualified people, and they are applying the power of business to resolve social issues, and they don't have small goals. Their goals are eliminate malaria, eliminate polio. This is not kind of stuff that you see like, geez, that's kind of thinking big. This is utterly remarkable. And so she said, she basically went from a great job to an even greater job. Job dissatisfaction was relative only. Examples of shocks. I've been using this a lot. I love these examples. I like this one in particular. When we did our interviews, manager told me I was better off quitting after complaining about a systems problem. This was a high-tech person. I like this one too. I was unhappy with the raise I received. This was during the dot-com period where everybody was making so much money. This person got a 10% pay increase and thought, what? That's insulting. Family shocks. I think these are pretty evident. My father was in a car accident. The person had to go back. I became ill and I could not work. I like this one. My husband got a job in Texas after graduating from college. Now, if you know anybody from Texas, it's hard leaving. I mean, Texas is this thing that just draws people, and people either love it or hate it. Just Texas is this wonderful place. And I like this one. I had a baby. I like this one. My manager made false accusations about me. That would upset me to no end. And so these are the kinds of things that people, when we ask them about these kinds of shocks. This one was kind of remarkable. I was surfing the internet. In 10 minutes, I found a job that paid me a lot more. Whoa, that's pretty good. And this one I keep thinking about. Could this ever happen to me? I saw an article in a magazine that my department was in jeopardy. If that doesn't get your attention, then, geez, maybe I should think about something else here. And then path four is a simple idea. It is, you do not have a shock. There's no script. You do this fit analysis, but it's to get to job dissatisfaction, our traditional notion of leaving. You quit because you don't like it, and you got someplace else to go. Very straightforward example. Just like the job, find another job. Well, our theory has been, I'm happy to say, I suspect I would not be here if I could not tell you this next set of information, that our research was on nurses and accountants. And one of the things about social science, that yes, you must corroborate your own research, but it's not enough. Because unbeknownst to yourself and your colleagues, you have this perhaps bias of supporting your own results or supporting your own ideas, so you have to let them go. You have to let them go and let other people study them. And so I'm very pleased to tell you that, well, the accountants in the UK were sort of supportive. They weren't as supportive as I'd like, but they were generally supportive. And the author concluded overall it was supportive. Nurses in Florida, a diverse sample in Minnesota, and numerous dissertation doctoral theses in China and in Europe. I've not read all of them, of course, but people sent me emails saying it was corroborated. Because of that, it's become kind of good. Another simple idea. How do you measure this? Focus groups, questionnaires, and the one I always want to highlight because I think it's so important that most people don't do. Manage it by wandering around. That came out of a book in 1982, In Search of Excellence. And the basic idea was one of the things you do is talk to people. Take people out for coffee and sit down and chat with them about what's going on. The job and life in general. Just get to know your people. I have a number of publications where I'm happy to send you if you want more specifics. Some practical implications. I'm going to go through a set. Well, among them include many events are off the job. We learned they are off the job. This is important because it talks about our next theory. Many events are positive. We always have this sense of you don't like your job because something bad happened. You could have a great job and still leave. Many leavers are satisfied. That's what that comes down to. This is the one we get in a lot of trouble for. For many people, money is secondary. I heard this wonderful presentation by our executive in resident of last year. And he said, you know, think about what you want to do. Of course, everybody wants to reach a certain amount of wealth. You have to be comfortable, however you want to define that. But after you reach your certain level of comfort, and his comfort level, he was a multimillionaire, he basically said, I want to give back. His primary goal is to give back now. We have in ours and many business schools these very successful executives who say, you know, I've really had a wonderful life. Now's my turn to give back. And that is such a powerful phenomenon. So money is a secondary issue for many people. Our research suggests it may be as high as 60%. And that, whoops, some events are script-driven, and you don't always think about dissatisfaction. You think of other things. So practical implications. How to deal with scripts? Change the work inducements. That's the idea of this Sioux Falls, South Dakota call center. I actually don't know if they followed up, but they felt it was one of those aha moments, and we said, pay the $500 after 1 year on the job to get people to stay and get a sense of what's going on at your company. Tailor responses to common scripts. So I encourage companies to have maternity and family support to respond to issues of local demand. So if you have a family and you really want to keep somebody, this is the kind of stuff I believe you have to do. In the United States, we're moving slower than we should, but we're moving in that direction, in my opinion. Dealing with shocks. Provide training to deal with negative shocks. In the United States, there's a Dilbert cartoon. I don't know if you know Dilbert, but I think it's world famous. I love this one because first Dilbert cartoon box, the boss comes up to Dilbert, and the boss says, I have some good news and bad news. Dilbert essentially says, well, what's the bad news? The boss says, you're fired. And then Dilbert says, well, what's the good news? The boss says, I went through human relations training. I'm supposed to be nice, so the good news I have to ask, well, how are you doing? Some training on how to do that in a little better fashion. Some kindness might be good. Kindness is a relative term. Some people have a hard time figuring out what they mean. Provide realistic job previews. You'll see that a lot. One of the things that you have is this long-term body of knowledge that says, give people an honest, realistic talk, explanation of the job, what to expect, the good stuff and the bad stuff. At my university, in my business school, I'm the person primarily responsible for hiring. We go out of our way to tell people the good and the bad, how hard it is, the odds of success. But when they come, if they come despite that, they're there for a long time. Provide support mechanisms to help people deal with shocks. I always think an informal grievance procedure. Now, if you're in a heavily unionized situation, you can't do that. But for a lot of other companies that are not heavily unionized, have some informal mechanism. This is the guy you go and complain to. This is the guy who can get things done. Good or bad, in my university for faculty, in my business school and faculty, I've become this person. So I hear everybody's gritches. Oh, that gets old quickly. Flexible work scheduling. If you can do this, I mean, we all have different lives. We're all different kinds of people. Sometimes people have to complain. You think of faculty. We have the most flexible job you can imagine. Part of that is because it allows us to get our work done. For many jobs, You don't physically have to be there anymore. You can be anywhere, working in your pajamas at home, anything. Have enough flexibility. Trust your employees that they don't have to be physically planted in their desk. My aha moment. We studied the unfolding model for approximately 10 years. And for 10 years, we thought, boy, this is really wonderful stuff. One day in 1995, we were sitting in this research group talking, and Terry Mitchell, in jest, my colleague, says, you know, he had been there at that point since 1969, and he said, I interjected, well, gosh, I've been here since 1983, and then Terry says, what the heck do we know about leaving? What we know about is staying. Then here's the aha moment. I said, gosh, might it be interesting to talk about why people stay instead of why people leave? I'm not kidding you. There was a sudden silence. People said, whoa, staying, that's so different. And because up until that moment, the answer to the question of why do people stay was because they didn't leave. It was kind of vacuous, but nobody ever talked about it. So we thought, well, gosh, why do people stay? And we came up with this idea of job embeddedness. Job embeddedness is a very straightforward notion. It has three dimensions of fit. Fit is this idea of, we sold it as a binary, you know or you don't know. Other people have made it more complicated. But our original idea is, you know. In Seattle, we joke that people are willing to take $16,000 a year and less money because when the sun comes out, you can see the local volcano, Mount Rainier. You go, wow, I got to stay. The water's out, you see the mountains, and you're thinking, my gosh, how can anybody leave this place? It's so spectacular. Links. Links is the idea of connections. You have connections to a location, you have connections to a place. And so the sense is, geez, it's hard to leave if you have connections. None of these things will keep you there in any absolute sense, but the idea is that they add up, and over time, it gets harder and harder to leave. The example we came up with was that Terry, who was very smart and very talented, had 6 PhD students working for him, and the sense was if he left, these 6 people would be in a world of hurt, and he just couldn't bring himself to do that. The other one is sacrifice. This is a well-known social psychological phenomenon of you tend to stay if it's hard to give things up. And so some of the examples we had was, I always pick on Terry. I don't know why. I shouldn't do this, but I always pick on Terry. Terry, he's a very colorful guy. Terry had been in Washington for University of Washington, and he had season's tickets for a local American football team. And every year you buy tickets and you get better and better seats. You pay more money, but you get better and better seats. Well, after 20 years of having season's tickets, he thought, I got great seats. I just can't give this up. Of course, if you really wanted to, you could leave. But you add these things up, and it just makes it a little harder. There are 2 components. In management research, everybody studies the organization, and it's aptly so. But one of the contributions we made was you can have fit, links, and sacrifice to the community as well. Sometimes it's just harder to leave Adelaide to move to Melbourne. You get so embedded in your community that it's hard on your family. The classic comment in Seattle is, my kid's in high school, I just can't leave. It just would be too terrible for the kid. And whereas job embeddedness is, or whether the unfolding model is relatively complicated, we wanted something that was going to be easy to measure with a questionnaire. Our research is with grocery clerks, hospitals, banks. I love the golf and fine dining because they gave us free coupons for, and we ate very well. In the United States, there is a golf course called Pinehurst. It's for the world-class golf. We got a phone call from the manager and said, oh, when would you like tea time? Like a not informed person, I thought drinking tea when they meant, and you know, that's a several $1,000 gift to be able to do that. I had no idea. Job embeddedness is very predictive of employee turnover. It predicts turnover in addition to, not instead of, but in addition to satisfaction, commitment, perceived alternatives, and other withdrawal cognitions. These are the things I put up front. Going back to an earlier comment, we're trying to pull together a whole bunch of variables to make sense of how you understand the staying process. Subsequent research has been supported with teachers, bank tellers, call centers, and other financial workers. I'm happy to say that job embeddedness has sort of caught on and is kind of a hot topic. I always tell my dean that all the time. In addition to turnover, it predicts performance, helping behaviors. Performance is defined as those things that appear on a job description. Helping behaviors are those things about every company needs somebody to help other people. It's not on your job description, but the company can't function if you have, unless you have those people who help other people do their jobs. Absences, group level, that's a fancy way of saying work team behavior and turnover rates. It's been supported in the United States, China, India, and in several countries in Europe. I don't know if it works in Africa. I don't know if it works in, you go off the coast of the eastern coast of China and go westward. I don't know if it works there. Conventional wisdom. What are you supposed to do? If you go out and read an HR book, among the common things they tell you is that you should regularly assess satisfaction and commitment, and companies do. You should have exit interviews, which, of course, is pretty common. And then you make the appropriate changes involving supervision, pay, work design, and traditional factors. You should do this. This is absolutely good. But other things you might do with respect to organizational links, if you want to create more links to the organization, provide mentors, design work teams, foster team cohesion, and encourage employee referrals. Encourage people to contact other people in the firm. Community links. We do this at my school. Encourage, support, and create community involvement. So we're always getting people involved with service organizations in the community, sports and recreation, get your kid involved with the leadership, and we're always trying to help families solve their problems. That's part of my job. I'm doing stuff, I have no clue what I'm doing, but I'm trying to resolve family issues. That's not my forte, but sometimes the sheer effort is what people appreciate. Additional practical implications for fit. Again, realistic job preview. Bam, there's just nothing better than that. Hire for fit. Hire for fit means that do they not just fit your company values and goals, but can you get it through assessment of personality, through assessment of just talking to people? Are they well suited to the demands of being an accountant? Are they well suited to do all the good and bad of being a nurse, so on and so forth for different professions? Communicate the culture. If you don't fit in the values of the company, if somebody asks you to do toxic dumping, and that's so contrary to the company, that person is going to be, that should be reported, of course, but you know that whoever's telling you to do that is violating what is supposed to be going on. And community fit. Recruit locally. University of Washington Foster School of Business is a very, very fine business school. But there, unfortunately, I say that from a selfish standpoint, there are many, many fine business schools in America. And so we always have to look for the angle. In our world, the angle is trying to get somebody to come home. I think Adelaide might be this way. Certainly, we heard it at Kangaroo Island. But people in Seattle usually have some desire to come home. Now, when I say home, I'm talking about the state of Washington, the state of Oregon, the state of Idaho. The sense is they want to come back to the great Pacific Northwest because it's a certain lifestyle you have. So we always look for, if we can find a connection, they get bonus points. Practical implications three. We think that you want to tie financial performance to incentives. You talk about, you hear about this stuff all the time, but we think you really ought to do it. What does that mean? In some places, we have, in my school, we have written down all our guidelines. For American University, that's kind of somewhat unusual. But we've also been asked by our faculty, well, show enough judgment in applying these guidelines, these rules, that you don't screw things up. One of the things they say, if you've been around a long time, you've done a good job, give these people more slack if they don't publish something every year. And that is so sensible. So try to create some sort of financial incentive to stay a long time. Provide unique incentives to the extent sabbaticals keep you there. Man, that's fantastic. Not all companies can afford that, but there are some wealthy companies that can do that. Community sacrifice. We always encourage home ownership because ownership ties you to the community, and that we don't do it at Washington, but many universities in expensive areas have home buyer assistance programs because they know they can't get faculty unless they do that. Develop career paths. And here we're thinking about academia is one of those areas in the United States that's a bit unusual. in that if you go into administration, that's not seen as a good thing. They joke, you go into administration, it's the dark side. And everybody's got to have a reason to go into the dark side. And so career paths, let people do what they love. Faculty love to teach and to do research. Give them the tools and the opportunity and the freedom to do that. During drinks, I could tell you why I went to the dark side. What do we learn from the unfolding model? There's a distribution of shocks. There's content of that. That implies that you have to do shock presentation. I don't know why I got this all out of order, but handle job offers. Have an existing policy. Every supervisor can automatically say, he has carte blanche, he or she has carte blanche to say, you can give this person automatically on the spot, if they show you evidence that they are leaving because of an offer, $15,000 pay increase. I just made that number up. Whatever amount of increase, give the authority to that supervisor. Determine the frequency of scripts. If you have a workforce that's got a very common script, can you work around it? If you've got a lot of high-talented young women who are in the age of giving birth, you may want to have extreme flexibility on taking time off and then helping them come back. Aggressive daycare kind of policies. These are kind of things that I tell people. This is not rocket science, but how come it's taking us 100 years to figure this stuff out? What did we learn from job embeddedness? We learned you got to match the person to the job. Fairly straightforward. Provide community fit resources. That's simply saying, if your kid likes sports, tell them about the local football team. Tell them the local baseball team. Create job links. We always tell people, work with other people. Get involved. Get connected so that it's a little harder for you. We don't tell them this part. So it's a little harder for you to leave. We tell people because it's better for your life and your research. Establish community links. This is the idea of if you're active in the PTA, if your spouse is active in the PTA, son of a gun, it's just a little harder to leave. Introduce on and off the job sacrifice. We do that by saying, you know, when the sun comes, we tell people a lot, you know, when the sun comes out, this is a pretty darn nice place to live. You know, summertime, it doesn't rain much. The weather's wonderful, low humidity, not hot. Gee, you know. And in the wintertime, you can go skiing. In the summertime, you go hike. We have to make all this stuff very, very salient. Preliminary evidence. There are three or four studies that support this, two of which I've done. And they aren't as good as I'd like them to be, so I'm a little hesitant. So I say the word preliminary evidence. We have found evidence that employees with higher job embeddedness experience fewer shocks. What we believe that means that higher embeddedness buffers the effect of shocks. So it doesn't lead you to think, well, maybe I should think about leaving. And this is a lot of syllables to say that for those people with higher embeddedness who experience a negative shock and stay, our knowledge about cognitive dissonance says that they really want to stay after that. The logic would be something like, I stayed, I could have gone there, I must really like it here. That's the sense that maybe embeddedness is capturing. People and organizational effectiveness. I'm not talking big picture. We know that knowledge, creativity, risk-taking, innovation, and old-fashioned work ethic, these are among the most important things about 21st century jobs. As you think about 21st century jobs, what does that mean for managing in 2013, 5 years from now, or 10 years from now? More than likely, it means that you're going to have to adapt. The conventional wisdom is still valid. You should hire based on general mental abilities, and you should hire reliable people. That's a fancy way of saying hire smart people who are reliable. That's good advice. You have to make a decision. Is that enough? Because we know that knowledge captured by smart people, we don't know if smart people are creative, risk-taking, innovative, but we know that old-fashioned work effort counts. As you go to the next 10 years, these other characteristics are things you may have to think about more seriously. But I always warn people in every presentation I make, the most common first name in the world is Mohammed. The most common last name in the world is Wong. How many Mohammed Wongs do you know? I submit not many. So when you talk about the statistical evidence, yes, you should know what it is. Yes, you should be willing to follow that. But what you want as the educated person, the educated manager, sometimes when you know the conventional wisdoms, you know the knowledge, you want somebody who can create an articulated and informed judgment. Informed judgment certainly is about conventional wisdoms and the research, but you want somebody to be able to articulate it and not just blindly follow the statistics. Now, if you're really truly clueless, that's a good thing to do, but we like to think places like the University of South Australia, we like to think certainly the Foster School, we do not have clueless people. We are educating people so that they are not clueless. The Cactus Team. This is, I always put this up because what are we doing now? These are some older guys who collectively we have about 145 years of studying turnover among us. And so I'll tell you why we call it the Cactus League over drinks, but we have come up with a new theory. And the new theory deals with, we want to deal with people who, I want to stay because I want to stay. People study those folks. I stay because I can't leave. Those people have never been really looked at. We're trying to look at those people. I want to leave and I can leave. We know about those people. We're trying to study them. And I leave because I must leave. Now, we know some about people who get fired. CEOs oftentimes get gracefully kicked out with a $10 million exit package. Yeah, I mean, that's not so bad. And we're trying to study what this all means in a new theory. That said, please go forth and do good things. It has been a great honor to be here. I have appreciated it, and thank you so much for your attention. You guys are great. Thank you.